Hello and welcome to In the Huddle. I'm your host, JT Thomas, broadcasting live from the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. Ladies and gentlemen, we just came off of a nice road victory playing the Iowa State Cyclones. Tonight, I got with me my co-host and my regular, Gary Tompkins. Thank you. And guys, you got to give it up for my main man, Rasheed Marshall.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. As I mentioned, guys, we just watched the Mountaineers come off a road victory after having a really tough game against Oklahoma. And we'll talk about that, but we'll jump right into talking about Iowa. Gary, we can win on the road. I was really kind of worried about going into Iowa, the fact that they beat Texas Tech early on, and then for them to have us coming the following week. But the good thing is we went in prepared, and after having a tough loss against OU, I thought we were ready and prepared to go. Talk about that. You got to keep her going.
First of all, let's give some credit to the Iowa team, because over the past few weeks we've seen that program take some steps to improve. You talk about the Texas Tech victory that they had just a couple weeks ago. They put up a lot of numbers. They could put a lot of big points that game. Pretty dominant. And so I think we look back on this game a few weeks ago or early in the season and pointed to this as one of those games, like we talked about the BYU game, being one of those trap games and maybe getting a look too far ahead and on to the next game. So I think it was a good showing on our part to go on to someone else's home turf whenever you do that and to have a big victory. So I was just glad to see our team bounce back from the OU loss. Like you said, we'll talk about that. But it was good to see them bounce back and have a convincing win.
Right. Rasheed, as you saw, I'm sure you watched that game, and to watch the Mountaineers get on the road, kind of pick the pieces up after losing to OU, to be able to get on the road and really go into that game really prepared. I thought they went in prepared knowing that they wanted to win that game and finish up on the road well.
Well, I said the first thing, when you get a team, you already get blown out by Oklahoma, you could can it from that point,
right?
You know? And if these guys weren't on track, they could have easily just cashed in, but for the fact that I think they're not used to losing. You know, in this season, they won a lot of games. They basically turned everything around from last season. So for that fact, I think they wanted to get back on track. You know, it's not like a Kansas team. You lose a bunch of games. It's the end of the season. You just cash it in. You know how it is. You guys play. So they want to get back on track, not used to losing. Two losses, and they got the win. That's what counts.
Right. And, you know, going into this game, I feel like Skylar Hire really had something to prove. I thought he had a tough outing against OU. And to get out there and really get his team focused, and I thought that's what we did early on. But the surprising deal to me is to watch the young running backs really get it together. We started off with Justin Crawford, who I think has just been doing an outstanding job this season, to finishing up with Pettaway. I have to say, for us to play nine games and to go into eight games and go into this game with not sure what we were going to do with the running back situation, Gary, I thought we finished up well with some young guys really showing us how football needs to be played in the for the Mountaineers.
The running game looks bright for the WVU football team, and I don't know who to give the credit to. What particular coach do I give it? To Coach Sider, one of my former teammates. Do I give it to who's ever recruiting whatever running back from whatever area? I mean, the future looks bright for us, and I was glad to see that we could almost plug in someone and then let them have a big night. I think it just goes back to what Rasheed talked about, what we said in the previous shows about our football team. This particular team, you can name a lot of successes from this year. In both games that they did lose, they turned around as though they didn't have a loss. They came out with intensity. They played well. They played hard. They represented our football team, our state, our school very well. And they've done that without the incidents off field. And they've done that without major penalties or looking like an unclassed football team. So I just give a lot of pride and a lot of honor to that team. And I'm glad to be able to see all of our players, no matter if they're our third or our fourth player down on the roster, to be able to come back in and play well and do what is expected of them.
Rasheed, something has to be said about in regard to the youth in terms of our running game. Crawford comes in out of junior college, not knowing the offense very well, but he's been very productive this year. And then you get the Pettaway kid, who has not seen any action all year, but went out there, and he looked like he'd done this thing a few times.
Yeah.
I was really good to see. Talk about, from a quarterback perspective, what kind of confidence or what needed to be said to a young guy like that to say, hey, we need you to show up and be able to perform like he did.
Well, I think that's a good point. But first of all, you take a step back and you look at how Dana made the adjustments this season. You know, he was a coach, like to come in, throw the football around, but he made the adjustments. So you get some guys in there, switch your passing game up to the running game, you're able to adjust and to adapt, you know, so to be able to fit those guys in. Don't lose a step and implement that running game into your offense is a big thing. So I think Dana did a good job with that. Second of all, as you mentioned, the younger guys being able to step in, picking it up. I think that just goes back to recruiting. You get a bunch of good guys in there. You go out, get guys who fit your system, and you can plug them right in. So that's a good job on Dana's end from recruiting and getting those guys ready to play.
Yeah, it just goes to show you that, you know, when you talk about team, right? It doesn't matter in terms of who's a blue star, a red star, or a three-star, a two-star. These guys come to play football, and that's what I like about the sport in itself. You get a guy who wants to compete, and it seems like our guys across the board, may it be offensive line. This year we started with an offensive line, and we had a guy go down. We had a young guy come in and do very well, and the whole offensive line really put it together and really been productive. To now having running backs, receivers, everybody preparing to give their very all in terms of being good ball players for our ball club, Gary.
I think, you know, go back to the running game. Running back's one of the most instinctive positions out there. You know, you don't have to think too much. Put the ball in your hand and just be an athlete. But the key to that is you're recruiting guys, like Rasheed said, fit the system, and you're also getting guys who know at some point in the season I'm going to play. When you watch TV as a high school senior or junior, you're thinking about where you want to go to school, and one guy comes in and says, hey, you know, I want you on my team, and by the time you're a sophomore, by the time you're a junior, you'll be our star running back, or by the time you're this age or that, you can share the reps. And you go to WVU and you say, you know what, I may not get all the carries, but I'm going to be able to get some of the carries this year. I noticed they played three running backs last year, or now in this case, they played four running backs last year. They had eight guys catch passes in one game, eight different receivers. Then you get a little bit excited about that, and those guys who are already, let's even say middle of the road to great athletes, they go out there and prepare a little bit harder. Why? Because they know they're going to see the action in the football game.
And I have to say, having 5 to 8 receivers playing the game has to do something for that running game. Mm-hmm. We had young guys. Marcus Sims caught his first touchdown this weekend. We got young guys catching touchdowns. We got veteran guys, Nikhil Shorts, being productive for us. It just, again, to me, we're in a great position as a ball club to continually be very productive in the Big 12. A couple years ago, Rasheed, I asked the question, when will WVU be in the upper echelons in the Big 12? And I have to say right now we're sitting at number 3 in terms of standing in the Big 12. We're getting there. What do you think?
Without a doubt. And, again, it goes back to recruiting. I think if you can continue to just build the base, get the guys in who fit your system, obviously, that's what's going to be the biggest beneficial dynamic to your program for the most part, getting the guys in that can fit the program. But you talked about the running backs, the younger guys. You're going to have guys who are unselfish players.
Right.
Running backs get hurt a lot. These guys are going to get banged up. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter. You can be the starter. I can be number 2. I know at some point in time it's going to come, you know. So it's going to be up to me to be ready to get in there and play.
Right.
But as far as where these guys are headed, I think they're headed in the right direction. Finally seeing that turnaround, and next year you continue to build.
You know, you go into this game, this is I think in the third game or so where we had over 600 yards total offense. That is a lot. You know, Gary, you and I have talked about that. That is a lot of offense, guys. You just don't realize how big that is.
Right.
Over 272 yards rushing, 341 yards passing. A lot of offense, Gary. Just bodes well for the Mountaineers' future.
It does, but it just makes me throw everything I know about football out the window because you're just not supposed to have those kind of numbers in a football game. But I'm glad to see that we're on the side, on the right side of that. We're the team that's getting the most yards out of after every football game. You know, we watched Crawford run a couple weeks ago, and I mean honestly, I didn't even recognize he had almost 300 yards rushing. And it just, I mean, just to see us gobbling up yards again and again and again, week after week. Same thing with our receivers. You know. You just wait for the explosion of Shelton Gibson. At some point in the game, he's going to catch a big, a long touchdown, or a long pass. So you just keep seeing these things happen with our football team. So it's exciting. It's exciting from a player standpoint. It's exciting from a fan standpoint. And I think it gives us a lot of reason to cheer on Mountaineer football. And we look at where we are right now and look at where we were just last year. And I think there are a lot of doubts about this football team, at least what we're going to end up record-wise. And you look at us now. Here we are, you know, just two losses. And I think a lot of people didn't expect us to do as well as we're doing. And even in some cases, maybe expected us to be a little bit better than where we are right now.
You're right. Well, we're going to be a little bit better right now because I'm going to give some away. Rasheed, on this show, what we like to do, we give out trivia questions. And all we ask for people to do is kind of listen what the conversation is about. And if you raise your hand, we'll get you the mic and give you an opportunity to win this really nice WVU sign here. I wish I had one of these. Hopefully you guys save me some down the line. But guys, to win stuff like this, you got to be here at the Green Turtle every Wednesday at 6 p.m. The question of the day, and I stated this, I need to know an approximate amount of yardage WVU put up this week. I've mentioned a few times the approximate amount of yardage this week, total yardage. Total yardage. Okay, I give you some multiple choices. Over 400 yards, over 500 yards, nearly 600 yards total offense. That's close. 400, 500, or 600? 600. It was 613 yards. Thank you, ma'am. Again, it's really easy. All you have to do is pay attention. We'll tell you all the time. Guys, remember, to do this and to win, you have to be here. If you don't catch us here, make sure you go check out all our episodes at the Depot, at the DominionPost.com. Look under the football section. We'll always be there. Guys, let's keep it rolling. Rasheed, how we'd like to do that. We talked a lot about offense. You're an offensive guy.
Yeah.
But Gary and I, we like to talk about defense.
That's right.
Right? We get excited about defense. And Rasheed, I'll start off with you, but I'm very happy that our defense did not allow a scoring touchdown this game. And I thought that was very impressive for our defense.
You know, I think the defense, Tony Gibson has done a great job all season.
Yeah.
Gary, you made a point coming in. A lot of people didn't expect a lot out of this football team.
Right.
You get Drayvon Henry out for the preseason or out during preseason camp, lose him for the year. You lose Darryl Worley last year, NFL draft. You lose a handful of seniors.
Right.
He pieced these guys together and put them in positions to make plays and win football games. So, you know, I think the defense is doing a great job. You look at it coming in. You look throughout the defense, who are we going to have? Who are we going to plug in? Who are we going to – all these guys stepped up. So I give the whole defense, the staff, the players, everyone credit.
Correct.
Going into it, I said it on this show. The number one concern that I had was none of these guys. And I think the only person that had experience was Noble and Christian Brown in terms of consistent play. And Jared Harper had a little bit. But everybody else has been fill-in guys and new guys who've been learning the system. And, Gary, I have to say there's one guy in particular that I'm really excited about, and that's Justin Arndt.
Yes.
Justin Arndt is an outside linebacker. He was a guy that everybody said was undersized, I think. He was 212 pounds, might be 5'11", and that might be generous to him, right? But everybody was questioning that guy. And right now, Justin Arndt sits at the top of the tackle board as a leading tackle for the Mountaineers. Talk about what that may feel like for a guy who's just getting his senior year, getting a chance to play, and he's showing up big.
I'm sure it means everything to him right now, and I think that's why he's playing so hard for us. You know, in football, you can measure guys on height, weight, speed. You can go ahead and put all the numbers in that you want to, but there's nothing you can do to measure heart. And that's one of the intangibles that a guy like Justin Arndt has, you know. And I played with some guys like that too. And you see them, and they're not supposed to make the plays that they make. They're not supposed to be as fast as they're not supposed to cut off the faster running back. They're not supposed to take down the bigger guy. But when you want it, you want it. And that's the kind of guy that we want playing football for the Mountaineers. And I think that, you know, he's finally gotten his opportunity. He's finally got his chance. I look at him as the Skylar Howard of the defense. You know what? I'm going to prove to you guys that I'm here, I belong here, and I should have had an opportunity to play before now.
You know, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to say, every single generation, there's been a guy from West Virginia who's been a walk-on who had to earn their way. I'm sure there was one year earlier. Yes. There was one for mine. He's that guy right now, you know. Didn't get a lot of looks coming out of high school. Undersized. Had a lot to prove. And all he wanted to do was just find a way, make
That's
a way.
Right.
And before you know, he's a starter on a Division I-A defense.
You know, and it talks about the defense in itself, right? When you guys played, when Rich Rod came in, you start getting linemen that were, for the most part, undersized in terms of they wanted a slimmer, faster offensive line because they wanted to do some zone stuff. With the 3-3-5, they wanted a faster, smaller linebacker who could come off the edge and get to the football.
Right.
And that's what we've been able to do. Now, on the back end of that thing, Gary, as you know, in the secondary,
right,
you got to look at guys like Kazir White, who's a transfer, who's come in and been very productive.
Yeah.
And then on your guy, on that corner, Rasul Douglas,
yeah,
8 interceptions on the year.
Man.
Gary, that's big from a junior college transfer guy. And then you've been big on Rasul Douglas from day one.
That's right.
And I have to say he's done an outstanding job this season.
You know, I think he first two games of the season, I watched him play football, and I had always said that I felt like he had the physical skills to be a good cornerback. You watch somehow some guys move in their position. You know, you watch him in the warm-up. He looked like he could play the position well, and you can tell he had a lot of confidence. Early in the season, I think he missed a couple tackles, or he stepped in front of some balls a little too early or let one get behind him. And each time, it just seemed like it didn't just ward off his back. It didn't bother him at all, and he just kept playing. And each game, he seemed to get those receivers stop getting behind him. He started breaking on those passes at the right time. He started, you know, actually coming up with the football. And I think each week he's gotten better and better at being a almost shut down corner. You know, he's not getting a lot of balls thrown his way, and the balls that are coming his way, he's making the best of his opportunity. He's getting his hands on them, he's making solid tackles, and I think he's played his way into a legitimate corner that deserves a lot of respect.
And I got to go to that front line. You know, as I mentioned before, we got Noble Wukachu and Christian Brown. Two guys who've done it before, really showed a lot of leadership in terms of being able to keep their team focused on getting to the quarterback, putting pressure on the guys. And if you think about it, I think about 3-3-5 and those guys not getting a lot of glory, but yet they've been opening the holes up for their linebackers to flow and get to the ball carrier. Just talk about leadership in terms of guys like Noble Wukachu and now Christian Brown.
Well, I went up against that defense basically throughout my career with Rich, so I know the ins and outs of it. Those three guys up front, they have to be selfless guys because basically what they're doing, they're going to get double teamed. They're just opening things up, as you mentioned, for the linebackers. So, you know, I think you get three good, solid linemen down there who are able to be leaders up front. You already know they're not going to get the glory. If they get to the quarterback, great. It's going to be by their ability, not necessarily by scheme. You know, it's the 3-3-5. They're just basically meant to take on double teams, especially the guy in the middle. So for those guys to just come to work every day, not get the glory,
right,
and play for the guys behind them, that's huge, man. And those are the kind of guys you need to make a team like West Virginia has right now.
You know, the good thing, you get guys like David Long, you know, mm-hmm, young guys are playing at a linebacker position. They're seeing the example,
right?
Right? They're seeing, for years to come, they see what it takes to have a good football team to turn a defense. I believe moving forward, these are guys that are going to be able to sell the 3-3-5 in recruiting. They'll be able to sell it at being able to say, hey, we were able to lose 4 or 5 guys and still be productive as a football team. Again, the overall picture, Kazir White, Long, Darren Howard, all those guys are new and young guys in this defense. Again, I just think it bodes well for the future of West Virginia defense.
Yeah, I think that falls into a story I like to tell. And this kind of flips back to the offensive side of the football, but you talked about building through recruiting, through schemes. Rich Rod came in. I had the reins for three seasons. Mm-hmm. They went down and recruited Pat, and they told me, we're going down, we're trying to get this guy to come up from Alabama, you know, fits the scheme well. Right. They got Pat in. Pat did his thing. Jarrett came in, Phil. So while Pat is playing, they're recruiting Jarrett. So they're just building the program from there. Jarrett leaves. Gino's being recruited. Gino comes in. So it's just a building block season after season that you can plug guys in. And as long as your guys flourish within the system, you're going to be able to build that program like you mentioned.
Right. And what you said, you know, in terms of what Coach Gibby's been able to do for these guys, right, he really made these guys believe into the system. And I have to say, I was always concerned. I mean, I've always been, I wouldn't say a critic, but very skeptical of the 3-3-5. Coach Dunlap was here. We talked about when I played, we ran even an offer, 4-3. We wanted big guys being able to dominate the front. But Coach Gibby's really made these guys believe that they can be a great defense running this 3-3-5, Gary. And again, I just really have to take my hat off to him identifying these guys, right, calling them dogs, and really making them show up.
Well, we have to look at how the game is changing. I think that's something very important here, because the game was once played, you know, 3 yards in a cloud of dust. So you wanted to have bigger linemen on the offensive and defensive lines. You wanted to make sure that you had linebackers that were going to be good size and take on the fullbacks, be some tough guys, and maybe run between tackle to tackle. This day and age now, especially in the Big 12, you got people putting 4 and 5 receivers out there. We talked about earlier how we even had 8 guys catch passes for us in the game. And so the game changes, sort of like what you see in basketball. There's no big center anymore. Well, you see that in football now. Why? Because you want the guards pulling and maybe getting your quarterback out so he can maybe do the old boot and waggle. Or you want to have your guys out there that are athletic big guys that can get in the way, and so your running back can do his thing. And so the way the game has changed on the offensive side has sort of mandated that change on the defensive side. So now you have to have guys that are going to be 220, 225 in that linebacker position. May not be ideal for the ISO all game long, but they can get to the flat, move to the hook. They can rush the passer. They can come in and blitz. And just think about just when we talk about like sandlot football. When you're on offense, playing sandlot, everybody wants to throw the bomb first. When you're on offense, defense sandlot football, the first thing every defensive person want to do is blitz. So Coach Gibby's making blitzing fun. He's making defense fun again. And I think that's the other thing that's making these guys want to play, because when's my time to go? When do I get to get a big sack, cause a fumble? When do I get to, you know, maybe step in the lane and where the quarterback wasn't expecting it and I can get an interception? So he's making it fun, but he's also making it work because he's got the right guys in the system.
What was interesting for me is when you look around the Big 12, right, I figured if it was going to work, you'd have other teams in the Big 12 running at 3-3-5 or some variation of it. Right. But they're not. They're running big guys up front. And yet we are being dominant in terms of – and well, I wouldn't even say dominant. I'd have to say teams come into West Virginia, play West Virginia, recognizing that they have to be mindful and respectful of that 3-3-5, because we're bringing guys from everywhere.
And that's the thing, the 3-3-5 is so versatile within the framework of that scheme, because it took me so long to figure it out. And this is just in practice, so I'm glad I never had to go up against it in a game, because you can walk guys up into a gap, show that you're going to bring pressure, pull that guy out of the gap, bring pressure from the opposite end. There's so much you can do within the scheme of it, and it leaves you just with the flexibility and versatility to just do a lot out of it. You know, you show the blitz, you pull out. Pull the pressure from the other end. And as long as you can get guys to fit the positions you talked about, adapting to the offense, you're going to have to get guys that can run. They might be a little undersized, but they fit that defense. And right now, the 3-3-5 is exactly like when the spread offense came around.
Right.
People are trying to catch on to it.
Right.
So it's just a very like heightened offensive scheme on a defensive side, you know, is very catchy to the eye. You see a lot of guys making plays and it's flashy, but you have to be able to know the intricacies within it to be able to run it.
you know, that's one thing that I, you know, my son was here when they was playing, he played under Coach Castile, and he would always talk about, you know, Dad, this is a difficult defense, you know. And I always just give my opinion on, right. you know, get up in there, you know, right. throw the flipper, you know. Right. And he's like, hey, it's not that type of party, you know.
Right.
But again, I'm just really excited that our guys does such a great job, and to go on an away game, Ames, Iowa, and be able to play against a team and not allow them to score a touchdown just really bodes well for our ball club. And I just want to say to the guys, I'm really, really proud of you guys, and let's just keep it up. Let's recruit guys. Let's talk up the 335 and keep guys coming to West Virginia. Okay, guys, we're going to keep it rolling. Guys, as you know, right. there's one area of the field that we always concerned with, and that's special teams, right? We hate talking about special teams, but we've learned to embrace it, Gary, yes. Because we kind of understand, for the most part, what we're trying to do. When you played, we always had a deadly return guy. You know, West Virginia was known for having a Tavon Austin or a Pac-Man Jones or a Nate Terry when you right. played. You know, a Mike Logan when I played. Now they not so much. Not
Darius
so much.
Renard.
Right. There, mm-hmm. You know, there's Renard. Yes. Mm-hmm. We don't look at punt return. We don't look at kick return as an opportunity to score. What do you think about that?
Well, the thing about it is, and I had an opportunity to be around some good returners. I had my first year was Sean Terry, mm-hmm. who was in that line of greats. You're yeah. former teammates as well. Could take a kickoff to the house in the blink of an eye, right. you know. So whenever he was back there, I knew he was going to be able to help me out because field position Absolutely. Is so important, especially today because, mm-hmm. you know, these defenses are doing so much to try to slow you down. So you get a good return in there, kick return, punt return,
right.
it's going to help you out in terms of average starting field position, which in turn is going to help to more points on the board because you don't have as long as field to drive on. So you get you a good return man who can, you know, make some guys miss, set up the offense. It's a good situation.
Yeah, and that's the only area that I'm looking for improvement on,
right.
you know, through recruiting, through us getting more, getting better. I guess for the most part, we've said we've been able to possess the ball on a punt. That was the number one thing that we were concerned with. We're at least now catching the ball. And I think over time, Garrett, we'll get to where we need to be.
You know, with the adjustments that this team has made over the last year, and again, we talked about the record and the change in the record, and I think being 3+ at this point in time in the year, I think the coaching staff, that's up to them because I still believe that the athletes are there. So I think it's up to the coaching staff to figure out what we have in terms of returners, what we have in terms of athletes, and the ability to stop the gunner or that person running down on the punt team. To allow our returners to at least get us a 7, 8, 9 yard return. What do we need to do to make sure that we are going to break this thing beyond the 20-yard line? The special teams is the one area that I didn't see the improvement on the football team like we did with the defense, like we did with the offense. So I think that's something that's good. It's going to take a lot of game film, a lot of time, trying to figure out really what went wrong in that area because I do believe we were breaking even for most of the year until maybe the last two games. And Iowa had that return on us for a touchdown, which I didn't expect to see because we've been solid at least. And so I think you know, we're just going to have to take a different look at it.
Right. Hey, and I should mention that we've had some volatility in terms of special teams coaching, you know. So I assume that might be part of it, you
right.
know. But, guys, I want to go ahead and give away something, so I'm going to keep it moving. Guys, I want to remind you, we're here every Wednesday at 6 p.m. at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. And as we do this trivia, again, all you have to do is raise your hand and think about what I said in terms of answering the right question. All I want to know from you guys, what is the name of the defense that West Virginia currently runs? What is the name of the defense that West Virginia currently runs? To win, and you'll win this nice little thingamajiggy here, is raise your hand and we'll get it over to you. What is the name of the defense? It's a 4-3, it's a 5-2, or 3-3. I had to raise your hand. 335.
335. Yeah.
335. All right, you got some. You're a winner. You're always a winner here. Good job. Good job. Thank you so much.
Congrats.
Guys, we certainly want to thank y'all, and it's good to see President Gee out there today. How you doing, President Gee? Good to have you here. Good to have you here, sir. All right, I like your tie. Again, guys, to win, all you have to do is come down here and check us out every Wednesday at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. And if you don't catch us here, make sure you go to DominionPost.com. Look on the football section. We'll always be here. Guys, let's keep it moving. You know, there's one area, and I have to go back. I talked about the positive, but I got to go back to Oklahoma, right? I said we were going to talk about it a little bit. I won't belabor the point. I'll stay on a little bit. I have to say that was the toughest loss for us this season because we didn't expect to lose at home with weather and all that. What'd you think about that?
Well, I think there's a lot of different factors that you can place into that loss. It was a very big game. It was a very big stage. Right. You had the pregame hype and the talk, which is, I mean, that's football, right. You know. But if it happens, you have to be able to keep your cool, you know, your knowledge of the game. Because as soon as that ball kicked off, it's the real thing. So you can't get out there, get caught up in the pregame hype, forget your assignments once the game starts. And I think that's kind of the, you know, the problem that happened that game. You know, you get out there so big, the lights are bright. Pre-game hype, and you get out there, the ball's kicked off, and you're kind of sleepwalking. You just forget your assignment. You forget everything that you're coached to do all week.
Right. Started off rough in that game, right, with the fumble on the kickoff. You know, that's just not our character. We tend to do a lot better on the beginning of the game. It's a night game, 8 o'clock game here in Mountaineer Stadium, over 60,000 fans. The difference, in my opinion, in terms of the weather, which I thought was going to be to our advantage, turned out to be just horrible for us. You know, there's a lot of snow when we first started, Gary. But obviously, we know that's not an excuse. But the weather wasn't great for us. And although at the beginning I had a good feeling, it started to turn south on us real quick.
This, again, to me, is one of those changes in football that I kind of got to get used to that I'm not used to yet. I think things went sour from the very beginning. And, I mean, I think things were going sour before the game even started. You know, I hate to say, you know, I guess my answer to a lot of things that I don't like is somebody got to get a penalty. Right. But that's how I feel. If you come out there on Mountaineer Field and you step on out the West Virginia side with any type of, you know, aggression.
Right.
And you, what you're telling me is that you're going to be the bully in my house.
Right.
And I can't allow it.
Right.
Somebody should have got a penalty. Okay. Right. What I also saw was a big crowd, but a very quiet, stagnant, almost nervous, anxious crowd.
Right.
And then we look at the first two plays on offense. The first play goes 7-8 yards off tackle. And, hey, where's defense? And then the next play, they drop a wide open pass, and I go, wait a minute, hold on, that's two potential big plays, but two plays that, you know, they were able to move the ball with ease. And then you watch what happened, is that I think they just were more physical than us. Unfortunately, you know, we talk about McCoy getting hurt early. Then we go and we get a big hit on defense, but we end up walking off the field. And the game just didn't look like we were physical enough. It felt like Rasheed mentioned the stage. It felt like I hate to say it, but we didn't belong on that stage that night. That it seemed like maybe whatever it was that we had going to this game and feeling like we had to prove ourselves, we didn't have the extra strength to match up to that. And I just, if I would like to blame it on anything, then I would say this is where our youth and inexperience finally caught up with us.
Right. And I agree with that, and I think you're spot on in terms of the stage and the light. You know, when we get out of character, too, in terms of, you know, we're getting these little mouthy confrontations with guys, I'm more so, you know, Gary, we mention this every week, physicality, right? I want to pop you in the mouth, you know? You can do all that, and if I catch you come across that middle, we're going to have some consequences and repercussions.
Right, that's
you
right.
Know? And I think that's how you settle a lot of that talking early on in the game. And again, that just didn't bode well for me. And then when we lost sight of who we are, and I talked about leadership early on, when you don't have leader to calm that down and get the guys focused on what the task at hand, Rasheed, it becomes a tough day to be on Mountaineer Field.
Without a doubt. And, you know, you go back and talk about being prepared for the game. If you look at Oklahoma, They came in. They played Houston. That was a big game right off the bat for them. Right. They played Ohio State. That was another big game for them.
Sure.
So they had already been in that environment before. West Virginia has played some big games, none as big as Oklahoma.
No.
So the fact that you get all the media attention, you get everyone in Morgantown, everyone in the state, you know, you're the big guys on campus. You know, so you hear that, and you go out there, and before you know it, it's too late. So that comes through experience. One of you guys mentioned being young and not being in that situation, but that's where you grow up. That's where you build it. Over time, you get a bunch of guys, get into those games. It's nothing new once you get there, you know?
Right. And you know, one thing of doing that game that was tough to watch, and I have to critique and say this to our fans. Guys, we can't have you bailing on us. We need you there, all right? When times get tough, Mountaineers, we stick in there. We have to have you on our side of being that 12th man. Again, it got a little contentious, and that's when I expect our fans. Specifically, I think we got behind a couple of touchdowns, and we saw our fan base kind of dwindle on us. And I think that impacted the guys some point. And I almost felt like
does.
You saw their play shift when they didn't see their fan base up in those stands, when they started seeing a little unreadiness with our fan base, Gary.
I mean, let's just face it, JT, me and you come from a different background. And so what I look at that is if, you know, some neighborhood kid pushed down, and there was your mom behind you saying, "You better go do something."
Right.
and you got a little bit more strength with you because mom just told you, but your mom bailed on you.
Yeah.
And you go, "Oh, wait a minute, what am I supposed to do now?"
Yeah,
and that's how I feel about the fan base right now. You know, when we go out there, and as a Mountaineer, you know how it is when you go out there and everyone's yelling, "Let's go, Mountaineers," and the crowd's erupting, and you can feel sort of that rumble, that vibration in the stadium. I'm ready to go.
Right, right.
But you run out there, and all of a sudden everyone's like, what's the matter?
Right.
Do you
right.
guys know something that I don't?
Right.
Or did you just see something that I – are you with me or you're not with me? And then when you bail on me, you know, wait a minute. Then from that angle, maybe this looks worse than it is, and I really don't have a chance. You know, and something else I want to mention. I can remember being here as a grad assistant. And I can remember even in my later years when Rich Robertson, I think LSU came to town once, and I mean, crazy excitement in the stadium. And I think we set like 70,000 or close to 68,000, I believe it was. Next week, which to me was the telling point, LSU goes home and they play a 1AA team and they pack the stadium. We come back home and we play. It was another 1AA team. It was, you know, and we set 42,000 in the stands.
Right, we didn't.
And so my question is, who are you coming to see?
Right, right, right.
Who you coming to see? And so that's the one thing that, back to what you were saying, we need loyalty. We need you to stick by us because that's how you're going to get that extra punch in. We're going to make that big play that make it turn into something else. I don't think the guys had that support in Oklahoma game.
I would say a proper response, and you mentioned it in terms of when our team is not doing well, we need to see those fans start the Let's Go Mountaineers
chant. That's right.
That might be the best response that you can do in terms of helping our ball club. If you see that we're behind or we see we're having some challenge, start the Let's Go Mountaineers, and let's see that stadium start rocking. And I guarantee you, as a player, and you know, you get a little more energized. And again, I think that's probably the most acceptable response where we're not doing well.
That's exactly where I was going to take it. And you guys being former players, you feel that energy. You know, you feel that energy coming back from the crowd. So whenever it's a flat game and you guys had the position where a team comes in, you're supposed to beat this team.
Right.
You're heavily favored, but you play down to the competition. Because that energy, it's just a heavy feeling, not a lot of crowd support, and it just carries over to the player. So that's how it happens.
Guys, you're hearing it right here. I think it's a general consensus. We feed off you,
right?
We feed after you. So when it appears that we're not into it, we need you to get as excited as though you would want us to be. So again, guys, this is what we're doing. We're Mountaineers. We love doing and performing for you. going out there being the best blue-collar team in America.
That's right.
So, again, the proper response when we're not doing well, let's get the Let's Go Mountaineer chant started. We all in agreement on that?
Oh, yeah.
I agree.
Absolutely. God, let's keep it rolling. I'm going to say we're done with Oklahoma, right? We're going to move
let's
on.
Let's be done. Let's move forward.
Hey, like coaches, they often say, look, the most important play is what?
The next play.
So our next opponent is coming up, guys, as you know, Baylor, right?
Yes.
Baylor's had an up-and-down year. Obviously, they've gone through some ups and downs, some changing in coaching staff. But as a team, whenever we play them, I feel like this is going to be a good game, and this is a game that we have to prepare for being our last game at Mountaineer Field.
Almost every Baylor game has been a good game, really. Honestly, it has. It's either been a shootout, it's been a tough game, it's been exciting. And you don't right now, you really don't know which Baylor team you're going to get. So you got to go out there and prepare for the best one. You got to go out there and prepare for the team that's going to be able to have some good athletes at the wide receiver position. Linwood's still been doing pretty good for the most of the season. He's probably been their one consistent factor there on offense. Don't really know what's going on. Honestly, in the last year, that team's been through a lot. They've had the allegations against them, coaching change. You know, who knows what's going on in that locker room or what's going on within that clubhouse. So if I were the Mountaineers, I'd still prepare for the best Baylor team possible.
Right. As you know, we had a tough out against Baylor last couple years, right? It's a game I think we have to win. It's going to be senior night, right, here at Mountaineer Stadium this upcoming Saturday. It's a game that I'm sure Scalahara wants to win. He wants to put on his belt and be able to go back in Texas and talk about beating three consecutive Texas teams in his senior year. Just talk about that in terms of last year, quarterback, big game, Baylor coming into your house.
Yeah, well, that is a huge moment in itself, senior night. It's your last game on Mountaineer Field. Like, you don't get the opportunity again. And, you know, for him, I know there are some other things going on in terms of the personal feeling, the feedback that he gets from the support around the stadium, the fan base. But, again, it's your last one. You want to go out on top. You want to be able to go out and make your mark. This is the last one. So, for him, I think he's going to prepare well this week, just as he has any other week, because he's played solid for the most part all year, Oklahoma exception. But I think he is going to be ready to go. It's going to be a special day. And for every guy, not only Skyler, they all have to basically just kind of come together and make that thing happen. Baylor, good opponent, a lot going on, coaches, allegations, you don't know who you're playing for, what you're playing for, but you have to prepare to win.
I agree with that. Guys, I'm going to break right in here because I think there's a great response to what we've been talking about. This is my trivia question, and guys, this is for the big one. This is the Owen Smith West Virginia legend folder, and this is a good one. All you had to do was listen to what I said. What is the proper response for West Virginia when we're not doing well? What's the proper response for my fans when we're not doing well? I got a hand up back there.
Fans need to yell louder, "Let's go Mountaineers."
There you go, right there. That is the proper response. If we're not doing well, everybody go, let's go.
Mountaineers.
Let's go Mountaineers. There we go. Thank you, sir. That is the proper response when we're not doing well and we need to get our team up. Thank you so much. Again, guys, we're here every Wednesday at the Green Turtle Sports Bar and Grill. If you don't catch us here, make sure you go to thedominionpost.com. Look on the football section. We'll always be there. God, let's keep it moving before we get to the question. I want to continually talk about Baylor. Again, you know, when we played Baylor a couple years ago, the two things that I saw we did, one time when we beat them down there, we were able to lock down their receivers. They tend to have good receivers. And then the second year we played them, we had trouble stopping the run, and particularly their quarterback. What do you see as some of the keys to beating Baylor right now? As Rasheed mentioned, they have nothing to lose. Right, so they're going to come here pinning their tails back and try to give the Mountaineers a second upset in Mountaineer Field.
I think it's just going to be athlete on athlete. Like we talked about, Baylor tends to have good skill guys. Like, again, we said the wide receiver and the running back position. And in the interior line, both sides of the ball, they're going to have some big, strong, muscular guys. You know, in the defensive line, you're going to have some guys that are big and thick but move well. They sort of fit into that stereotypical Texas linemen. And so I think what's going to be the biggest challenge for us, I think on defense, is matching up with those heavy linemen. On the outside corners, I think we're just going to have to see, it's skill on skill, and we're going to get challenged, and they're going to see who's the better man in that regard. But I think our secondary has held up well. We got a lot of guys playing, and I think it's just one of those games you got to play.
And, Rasheed, as I mentioned, Baylor don't have nothing to lose. West Virginia has the opportunity to really pin their ears back and get after it also. You know, we've secured bowl eligibility. I feel like we have nothing to lose. I think our guys go out there and compete very well. Talk about what the excitement level is going to be for our Mountaineer guys and our attitude toward playing Baylor this upcoming Saturday.
Well, I think the approach that West Virginia needs to take is the approach that they've taken all season. They've done a good job, but it's all about preparation. Yeah. And for Baylor, because they don't have anything going forward at this point, you have to be ready for everything. Baylor's going to try to basically build their momentum going into the offseason. So you have to get ready. Trick plays, right. Gadget plays, special teams, everything that they can pull out, they're going to pull it out. So the biggest thing for West Virginia, preparation, continue to come to the table just like you have off season. And, we mentioned senior day. You can't get caught up into it too much, Don't put too much emphasis into that. Follow the script, do what you've done, and play your game.
I agree with that.
Now, I'm going to have to disagree with you for a minute, though, JT. There is something at stake here. What we have is our best season in the Big 12
right.
at stake. It's different if we were playing Iowa State last versus Baylor last, simply because of recruiting. This is the last thing that those guys that we want to get out of Texas, this is what the last thing they're going to see. And so for those guys who were wavering on whether I want to go to Baylor or Texas because they're getting a new coach or the TCU team, or maybe I want to try West Virginia, this may be the last time we get to put that product on the field for them, and they get to say, you know what, I think I'm going to stick with West Virginia. Or some of these guys that we get out of Pennsylvania, like Rasheed, that are going to be have a big impact on our football team. So I think a little bit of that is at stake. The crowd thing and senior day, I think you're right about that. Kind of let that go. Soak it in. Get there early. Hopefully coaches plan to get there early. Do what you can because that's a special moment. But there's still something to ride on this football game, because the other thing we don't want to do is just say, well, we made the bowl game.
Right.
And then we end up getting shortchanged somehow in that.
Right. You make a good point. So when I think about this in terms of it being our best season in the Big 12. I have to say, I've been asked many a times around the water cooler at work, how long before West Virginia's competitive in the Big 12? I said in 5 years from when we started. It's certainly been under 5 years. As I mentioned, we're at the top three right now in the Big 12. And really, that's what you're saying, is that stating the fact that we are a contender now. Mm-hmm. Starting off the season, we were, I believe, 7-8 in the Big 12. Right, so we've come a long way, and this is really icing on the cake. But to get that icing, you got to play the game.
Right.
Our guys have to come here. Our fans have to be ready to take on Baylor give our guys a fighting chance here at home.
I think with this team, we already talked about them, West Virginia, they have basically surprised and shocked a lot of people. Yeah. Very good product that they've put out on the field all season. They have reached a point where they understand what it's about. Right. They understand you get that little bit of taste of winning, you want more. Mm-hmm. You want a little bit of more, a little bit more. So I think they understand what it's all about and how important it is to be able to close this season out on a high note.
Great
I think
point.
We're boosting expectation now, too, because like you said, we went from 7-8 in the Big 12. Personally, when I felt coming into the Big 12 that we were going to always be fighting for that 1, 2, or 3 spot. I thought that we were going to be a team that can compete in the Big 12. I never doubted that. But I think that now that our team and our fan base and our players can see that we can compete in the Big 12, that now it's time to boost up the expectation to say, you know what, now forget competing in the Big 12. We want to be in that number one spot. We want to be the Big 12 champions. And get to a point where finally, since they won't open this thing up, get into that playoff system.
Absolutely. Guys, we're going to go ahead and move into our next phase. Guys, as you know, we always ask our fans to participate. So we're in the portion where you get to ask us questions that you want the answers to. If you would, raise your hand, and we'll get a mic over to you, and we'll answer your question to the best of our ability.
Don't be shy.
Don't be shy. Any question? We got Rasheed Marshall here. Questions. Okay, I'm giving away some stuff. If you answer questions, ask questions, I got some subscriptions to give away. All you have to do is raise your hand. Questions.
All it takes is one. Once you get that first one out of the way,
that's it.
Then it starts flowing from there.
Right. I got one.
Okay. What is your guys' feeling about two of our top three rushers in single game are both against Oklahoma, but both in losses with Tavon and Crawford?
Interesting. That's a good point.
Well, you got to play the game. And, you know, it's sort of that next man up mentality. You got to always be prepared. Obviously, those guys are great running backs. Those guys, you know, gave us a lot of numbers this year. They gave us a lot of effort. And we really needed them in our team. What we saw last week, though, is that we had guys who were ready to play. And we just had another running back, someone else who was prepared. And I think even for the Oklahoma game, that was the difference. I think going into the Iowa game, Pettaway understood he was going to have to cut, and you saw him carry the load. I don't think he understood that going into the Oklahoma game, so we didn't release him.
Right.
And so I think that goes back to coaching, recruiting, whatever it is that we have that we're selling, the players need to buy it. And so buy into the system that, hey, you may have opportunity to play. And when it is your opportunity to play, then we need you to go out there and play big for us.
And I think that's hindsight is 20/20 in terms of we knew going into that game that Shell was injured. He was going to be injured. We know that Crawford was a little banged up. Mm-hmm. And then Kennedy got hurt early, right? Mm-hmm. So with hindsight being 20, I would have rather seen Crawford play and spit some time with Pettaway. Right? But again, hindsight 20/20. I think that Crawford, in terms of big games, he has seemed to exhibit the ability to step up in some of those big games. Oh, yeah. Essentially, when we played Oklahoma State, I thought he did a good job of being prepared to play. So again, Tavon did a good job against OU. I thought Crawford, as you just mentioned, did a great job against OU. Those are special guys that are able to notch that thing up when we play against big teams. And again, I hope that we find ways to step it up moving forward.
I think Dana has a recipe to be able to run the football against Oklahoma. If you look back, not only Tavon and Justin Crawford, did they have big games against Oklahoma, but you go back, Charles Sims, he had a big game. You go back, you look at the one guy that went to San Diego. He was a free agent. Can't think of his name at the moment. Jeremy Smith.
Yes.
He had a big game against Oklahoma. In Norman. So I give Dana credit for basically being able to dissect that defense and knowing how to attack it on the ground.
Good point. Good question. Got another question.
Yeah, on the when Pettaway burned his red shirt, I assume, in the thing, what is the criteria for using a red shirt? How long can you play before you lose a red shirt as a freshman or
as a football player? I don't know that answer. So what I think is it was really interesting that we burned it. I think it can be again, I just don't know the specifics of it. I think we did it because the coach felt we needed to do it in terms of running back. We just didn't have enough depth. So whether we play him now or when he gets to a bowl game, we're going to have to play him anyway. So, again, just don't know that criteria. Do you know the criteria, Rasheed?
I think it's a percentage of plays. So if you go back and take all the plays from one season, and I could be wrong on this, but I think so you have 100 plays in a season for a number. It's a percentage. So if it's 10% of that 100 plays that you played in, your wrist are just burnt.
That's one of those. That's one of those questions that the players always leave up to the coaches.
Right.
Because it's sort of like after the long kick, the field goal, and you miss it, and everybody stands around the ball for a minute and go, wait a minute, can I pick this up? Can I not pick it up?
Right.
Do I touch it? Everyone kind of forgets. That's one of those rules that are way back in the rule book that most players don't know, and you understand it. My friends at home told me, hey, I could play X amount of games. You know, one of my friends went to another college. I can play X amount of games and still keep my red shirt. And then I learned here, you can't play any games or you'll lose your red shirt. And it's one of those coaching rules.
Well, I know my son played his first year, played against Marshall, played in that game. But he got a medical red shirt and was able to play in 5 years. So I do know that.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I think... again, that was probably based on that formula. He didn't play more than 3 games. He may have dressed for those games, but he played the 1 game against Marshall. He was prepared to play the 2nd game, didn't get in, and just dressed out the rest of the game, and they were prepared to burn him if it need to. But I'm really happy that they gave him 5 years to play. Great question. Any more questions? I got 3 minutes. Any more questions? Thank you, sir. And look, you get to win something.
A couple weeks ago, one of our defensive players put his hand on an official. In all my years of coaching, that's probably one of the rules you never, ever do. And nothing has been spoken about that in the paper, and I'm sure they took care of it in-house. What do you think? I mean, because defensive players, we get excited. Our adrenaline's flowing, but you never, ever put your hand on an official.
And I would plainly say I would agree with that. I mean, that I think that's a consensus in terms of all athletes. We know that rule. So, you know, that guy got excited, you know. And there's no excuse for it. I'm not going to try to make an excuse. We all know that as athletes, it's better to walk away. And oftentimes, we also know the person that retaliates usually get caught retaliating. Again, so there's no argument with me in regard to appropriate action. Hopefully, our team will address it appropriately. But we all understand that as athletes that you don't put your hands on officials. It shouldn't even be something that we should have to address.
Don't touch anybody, but especially the people in authority. Not, you know, that's just really what it is. You know, don't put your hands on anybody, but especially the people in authority. Don't go to the hospital and get physical with your doctor. You know, don't touch the police officers. Don't touch your parents. None of that. Just leave the people in authority alone. Yeah. Obey the rules.
You know, I know we said we were going to move on from the Oklahoma game in itself, but if you go back, you look at the breakdown in that play, that's another uncharacteristic move that happened.
Correct.
That you get in a big stage, you lose your cool.
That's
you
right.
Haven't seen that in seasons, you know, and
right.
You get into a game of that magnitude and have something happen, you just blow up. So that's another tally mark that you can add to
sure.
Just all the mental breakdowns that West Virginia had that night.
Good point, Rasheed. Good point.
Yeah.
Again, that's what we understand as an athlete. You tend to retaliate and be the one who get caught on a national televised game, you know, doing something that you're not supposed to do. You know, again, we recognize the game as being able to have a controlled chaos and being able to be very physical within the borders of the football field. And that's what football players get excited about, right? When we feel like we're unjustly being reffed or we have some issues, we try to take it out on the opponent.
Sure.
I mean, that's how I see it.
Right. Well, I that's why I think that we were so disappointed in the fan base, because let's face it, when we look at TV, there's always some characterization of West Virginia and how we're supposed to behave. And so this is why I think this was our country, our community, we the country of West Virginia, because it's us versus everybody else anyway. And I think that just showed up in the announcer's comments. We got a well-coached football team, and we got a bunch of good guys on our team. And like, and you've seen it all year. There's no off-field incidents. There's no problems in-house. We don't have bad athletes and doing criminal things. We got a bunch of really nice, good football players that do a lot of hard work. And so I don't buy into what he's saying. And I'm just going to continue to say it's us versus everybody else, and we're fine with that.
Yeah. All right, one more question.
So, Rasheed's quarterback coach for a couple of years is Bill Stewart.
Yep.
Any funny stories about Bill Stewart?
I have plenty. Coach Stu, oh, man. He was a good guy, but you know, there's one thing that always stood out about Coach Stu. So we would come into the meeting room. The board is up, and it's pitch black in the room. He would have a laser pointer. So he would stop right in the middle of the film session and just point the laser at different guys, you know, and ask you, like I'm looking at you, in a very serious manner, do you love football, son? Do you love it? You know, so as a young teenage kid, you're just like, yeah, I love it. I'm here, you know. Yeah. So you don't know how to take Coach Stu at certain times, but he was just so passionate and just so energetic about everything in terms of coaching and just wanting his guys to be prepared, because the product that went out there from the quarterback position was a reflection of him. So he was just wanting to make sure everything was running smoothly. And you know, Coach Stu was a good guy. We could stay here all night with stories, but that's one good one. He was a good guy, man.
Yeah, you know, one comment I had about Coach Stu, I remember my senior year, I almost broke my neck. I didn't play my last game. So my senior year, I ran out of the tunnel, and my arm was in a sling. I almost broke my neck against Miami. And my son asked Coach Stu, could he wear my jersey for his last senior game? And it just shocked the crap out of me, because I was up in the alumni box, actually, watching the game, and I watched my son run out onto the field with my old jersey from the last time I played. And I thought that was just a first-class move by Coach Stu to allow him to do that. So, again, I mean, obviously there's a thousand great Coach Stu stories, and I just wanted to share that about a very classy guy.
I actually have one more. Were you about to say something?
No, you go ahead.
So Coach Stewart went to Fairmont University, Fairmont State University. He was an offensive lineman at Fairmont. So it is what it is. Offensive linemen, they get down and dirty. They're in the trenches. You know, they have a mentality just like the defensive linemen. It's a war every single play down in there. So Coach Stu, now he has the quarterbacks. And every single guy in the room was just – you know, kind of laid back, easy going. Myself, Pat, Dwayne, Adam Badnarik. We had a good room of guys. But Coach Stu's thing was we weren't gritty enough. We weren't dirt, you know, we weren't linebacker mentality type players, you know. So he would always say, you guys just like to go down to the Mount Lair, wear your bell bottoms and look good in your zoot suits. You know, that was his thing. He, you know, we just weren't tough enough for him. But so many good stories, man. But the bell bottoms and the zoot suits was one that he always went to. That's some good stuff.
I was just here as a grad assistant during the time Coach Stewart's here. I don't have any funny stories. I just remember a very kind, very nice guy. And, you know, the only thing I can compare him to is the Coach Nealon. You know, I think I've made some posts before about him and the genuine care and concern he had for you as a person, as a player, and taking the time to talk to you, to do what he can to coach you and to help you be a better person, be a better athlete. Those are the things that I remember.
All righty. Guys, with that, we're going to get ready to wrap it up. And I want to share with you guys, if you want to go check out all the shows that we've done all season, just go to the Dominion Post, look in the football section. We'll be there. Obviously, I want to thank the Dominion Post and the Green Turtle for supporting and providing this platform to former players as we have done all season long. And I just want to remind you guys, always remember to just huddle up. So until next time, huddle up.